south of the border, down Mexico way. That's where I fell in love when the stars above came up to play. And now as I wander.
Hello there, all you expat wannabes. I'm Johnny Mueller, and you're listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America, the show that tells you just what it's like to live, work, play, and or retire down here in Latin America. It's a mix of the good, the bad, the ugly, and the great, and it's all right here, so let's get started.
Yeah, back in the saddle again with The Expat Files show. You know, it's worth the price of admission, they say, especially since it's free. You get what you pay for, huh? Speaking about getting paid, lots and lots of would-be gringos and expats, that'd be expat gonna-bees and wannabes, are thinking of coming down, but they're also thinking, hey, I gotta make some money once I get down here. So they often get together with me in a phone or a Skype consult, and then we talk about their particular skills, what they're good at, more importantly, what's needed here, the demand for certain services and skills here in Latin America, and how you can fill that gap. And also, of course, do you want to be your own boss, which is infinitely preferable to working for somebody else? Hey, if you're a wage grunt up in the States, you know that already. However, there's always been a kind of a stigma attached to being your own boss because most people are wage grunts. Not only that, there's a persistent rumor going around that if you are your own boss, you'll be working 60 hours a week, which is usually true. So you better love what you do, and generally, when you start your own business, that seems to be the case. After all, when you start a business, it's your little baby. Anyway, if you've never been your own boss, there's a little bit of fear and trepidation attached to that. I mean, look, the reality is, if you come from a family of union wage slugs, and there's no one that you can look to who's got his or her own business they started from scratch, you know, successful uncle or aunt, someone in the family or a friend who's a mentor, then you've really got no one to lean on because you'll be reinventing the wheel. And that's no fun at all. However, you might have a family that's just loaded with entrepreneurial types, which more than likely meant even as a kid, you had no fear about trying to start something yourself. But as far as gringos working here in Latin America, the main thing now is the internet. And that turns out to be a very good thing for a lot of reasons. For one thing, that means less and less people are opening up traditional mom-and-pop restaurants, bars, hotels, etc., which are almost never sure things because you got nothing but competition from everywhere, especially since most gringos and expats end up on the gringo tourist trail, and your competition will then be other gringos, which is the worst kind of competition to have. Talk about gringo expat mistake number one. In fact, I've been down here long enough and I've seen enough for myself to think, man, anyone who opens a bar or a restaurant here in Latin America on or near the gringo tourist trail is an idiot. However, when you're off the gringo tourist trail, it's a different story. When you're off the trail and your competition is nothing but Latinos, anything goes if you're a gringo and know how to organize things. In fact, I've seen some enterprises take off that if I was a betting man, I'd have said when they first started out, man, you might as well go to Vegas or play the horses. But I was wrong. Their gringo advantage kicked in and they kicked ass. So anyway, as you might think, just like up in the States, here in Latin America, you want to have an internet business if you can, because then, since you can start out from your own home or apartment, you won't have any startup costs. And that most likely means no government permits, no taxes, no lawyer fees, or very minimal, and no other employees except yourself. Of course, that'll change if your business expands, but at first, it'll just be you. Oh, and another huge advantage, they're extremely mobile too. So if you plan on moving around, just grab your computer or smartphone, find a good internet connection, and you're in business again. So I repeat, when you come down here to Latin America and get that plan B going, if you do absolutely need to get a job, and some people get a job even if they don't need one because they have to have something to do, that is besides golfing, sleeping, drinking, and eating. In fact, I'd say most people who say I'm coming down to retire don't retire at all, which is a great thing because retirement can be, and usually is, a certain kind of stress itself. It's mentally fatiguing, at least for above average people, and sometimes the quickest way to become a stand-up drunk. If you want to know what that's like, you'll have no trouble finding a few of those every time you walk into a gringo bar. Oh, and about those gringo bars. I don't care how far off or on the gringo tourist trail you are. There'll always be a gringo bar or two, or 10, because you see, gringo bars fill a niche. And believe me, there ain't no niche for gringo bars anymore. You see, all over Latin America, if not the world, that niche was filled way before you were born. So if you think you've got some great idea for a gringo bar and you want to put it into practice, be my guest, gringo. Go ahead. Blow your savings, reinvent the wheel, and join the thousands of other gringos who did the very same thing and who are now working as bartenders for someone else. It's the same for restaurants and mom-and-pop hotels, too. Hey, I'm not saying it can't be done, but if you're on the tourist trail, you've got no gringo advantage, and the odds are stacked against you. So then what about some viable gringo job opportunities, far away from the booze and hospitality business? Well, I'll tell you, I see gringo job opportunities all the time. And there's one for sure that's absolutely always in demand, and you never seem to be able to find one when you need him. That'd be your local gringo slash expat tax preparer. Because you know the vast majority of gringos and expats need to get their taxes done, or at least filed, whether they owe money or not. And as it turns out, quite a few gringos and expats have a rental or two back home, something back there, bringing in a little money, or even a private pension that's being shipped back to your Plan B destination. And in that case, if you make over a certain limit a year, usually for a single person, it's around 12 grand, you have to file taxes. And if you have income-producing assets or money coming in from back in the States, you probably have a tax preparer, and you know it's not an easy thing to do it yourself. Unless, of course, your sole source of income is Social Security. In that case, and here's something most people don't know, if you're simply on Social Security, you don't even have to file taxes at all. Nope, that's a fact. You don't have to mail in a form or file online at all. That's because only half of your Social Security income is taxable. So take, for example, a guy that makes 15 grand a year on Social Security. That's probably about average. If he's taxed on only half of that amount, or $7,500, he does not have to file taxes at all, because the law says you only have to start filing after you make $12,000 a year. That's for a single person under 65. If you're over 65, it's $13,500 a year. Now, for the exact amount, you have to look at the IRS taxable income table on that. It's always increasing a little bit every year. So I know for sure when some gringo says, you have to file taxes every year or you'll get in trouble. Well, that just means he doesn't know his ass from Hillary's face, which is probably a bad example because most people would lose in that guessing game. I know I would. Anyway, just know if you're living on Social Security alone and you have no other sources of income, you do not have to file taxes. Although statistically most people do because they think they have to. Look it up. It's not true. That means there are hundreds of thousands of people on Social Security throwing a couple $100 away every time they have H&R Block or someone else file their taxes. Or you could be wasting a few hours of your own time if you file those forms yourself. In fact, a couple of times a year, the Social Security Division will send you some snail mail, that is, if you get Social Security. Now, if you actually read those things and you understand government doublespeak, it'll point out right there in black and white that you may not have to file taxes at all if Social Security is your only source of income. But we were talking about gringos, expats, jobs, and niches, right? One of those great niches, again, being an expat tax preparer. But that'd certainly mean you have to have been accountant, bookkeeper, or tax preparer in a past life. And that's definitely not the case for most people. Anyway, it is a niche that definitely needs to be filled. All right, then. Another expat gringo slash Plan B opportunity that always seems to pop up. It's a niche that needs to be filled, and I'm reminded of it practically every time I get an email from an expat, usually a fairly new expat, asking me if I could refer them to anyone that would be an English-speaking expat like themselves, and it would have to be an English-speaking expat. They're looking for a gringo expat, a qualified gringo expat, who could do a house, apartment, land, or vehicle inspection. The thing is, I'm always running into gringos and getting emails from expats saying they've run into what they think is a great deal in a house, car, motorcycle, whatever, but they don't know how to evaluate it. In other words, there are tons of gringos and expats out there who would like, for example, to buy a motorcycle, car, house, land, whatever. And being in a foreign country where they don't speak the language, they have no idea. Is it a good deal? Bad deal? No deal? Worth the asking price? What about the asking price? What's it really worth? Is the paperwork in order? Is it registered properly? Especially when it comes to buying a property or a car. Now, I know after building 12 or 13 houses down here and being an engineer myself, I could be that guy. But I don't want to be that guy. However, I know there are lots of gringos and expats out there who were contractors back in the States or great do-it-yourselfers, tinkerers, mechanics, etc. could easily set themselves up to be that guy. Believe me, every expat gringo who's been down here any length of time has had a need for one of those guys, especially female expats, gringos. Sure, it's true, if you're out looking for a car, a motorcycle, a house, whatever, you can always find a gringo or two to go with you and check the place or the vehicle out just for moral support, but are they qualified? Usually not. I mean, look, don't you wish there was someone you could phone up if you found what you thought is a really great deal or a desperate seller, whatever? Especially if you're going to spend 50, 100, 150,000 bucks on a property. It'd be worth $100 or $200 to find out if the place was really in good shape or needed some big-time work. Or let's say you found two or three cars on OLX.com. Don't you wish you could phone up an English-speaking gringo ex-mechanic and pay him $50 or $100 to check it out before you make the deal? Besides the fact the average gringo doesn't know much about plumbing, electricity, concrete, or car mechanics, it's even worse if you can't speak Spanish. So if you've got those kind of skills, man, there's a market down here. And you won't really have to speak Spanish, though it's a plus and it would be nice, because a car is a car and a house is a house, no matter where you go. You just do your inspection. It doesn't matter if you can communicate with the seller or not, because you're working for the prospective buyer. By the way, speaking of cars here in Latin America, you see lots of old death traps and pieces of crap. And you wonder, how in the hell do those things stay on the road? Worse yet, since it's all about the show here in Latin America, aren't those things a terrible embarrassment to the owner? I know it doesn't make sense, but this is Latin America, you know? Even on your first trip down, you'll get into taxis that are pieces of junk, broken gauges, windows that don't work, even giant cracks in the windshield. Not to mention practically every car that's over 5 years old has a zillion little dents in it. Oh, and talk about a hygiene problem. When you get in, don't look too close because you'll find dozens of stains and skid marks on the upholstery. Ugh, what's that all about? Better not to speculate. You'll find that with all used Latin cars and trucks. And you'll find that with Latin living room furniture, too. You know what that means, folks. Skip the white duds or pay the consequences. And, you know, Latin governments, as lax as they are actually starting to do something about it. Nope, not about the multiple stains you don't want to know the origin of, but about the fact that so many cars and trucks are death traps, just pieces of junk. You see, some Latin countries are starting to put an age limit on the cars you can import, which might have an effect on you if you're planning on driving a vehicle down. There's a 10-year-old limit on imports that's been showing up a lot in Latin countries these days. Of course, that means if you bring a car in that's 9 years and 11 months old, once you get it in, you can drive it forever. Oh, and here's another thing Latin governments do that's completely ass backwards. That's the way they charge you for your yearly renewal on your license for your vehicle. And they all do it this way. For example, if your car is new, you pay more for your yearly renewal. So as your car gets older and older, you pay less and less. And after about 15 years, it's almost nothing. Which, if you ask me, is just the epitome of another governmental brain fart. When they could have used that licensing technique to clean up the cars and the pollution. Because you see, if they'd have done just the opposite, made it more expensive to own an older car, in a matter of a few years, all the junks and death traps would be off the road. For example, in countries like Peru, Honduras, and Dominican Republic, if your car is newer than the year 2010, you pay around $100 a year for your license renewal. However, if your piece of junk was manufactured between 2000 and 2010, you pay $50. And if your soot-belching death trap was manufactured before the year 2000, most countries will charge $25 a year. So Latin countries give a break and in fact encourage people to own junks. All right, speaking of cars and traffic, all Latin cities have big traffic problems because there's no such thing as infrastructure or civic planning. And of course, every city's got civil engineers on their payroll, but their immediate bosses are almost never qualified. They're just the dickhead sons and daughters of crooked politicians. Turns out, throughout Latin America, just like in Chicago, once a politician gets elected, it becomes the lard-ass Friends and Family Full Employment Act. But I digress as usual. Where were we? Oh, yeah. So traffic in all Latin American medium and large-sized cities is bad and getting worse due to the fact that car and motorcycle dealerships are now offering quick and easy credit with no money down. That's all new. It's never happened like that before. And of course, in certain Latin cities, the populations are growing like crazy. And that means more cars and motorcycles, too. All right, that said, here's a question for you. Which Latin city is rated number one for the influx of gringos and expats? Well, if you can't guess, it's easy to find out. Just go to the International Living website and see what they're promoting, their flavor of the month or the year. Now, you might have guessed Cuenca, Ecuador, and you'd be right. And as you might expect, Cuenca, Ecuador's city fathers are kind of terrified that the population will soon outgrow its infrastructure and resources. So accordingly, experts from Ecuador's Institute of Statistics are sounding the alarm. They're saying the growing population will be needing many more resources such as clean water and advanced city planning to provide adequate space and proper living conditions for the influx that's coming now and in the future. The head of the agency saying, quote, "I don't see any sign that our growth will subside anytime soon. Cuenca has become what is known as an international magnet city, attracting people from other cities in the country and first world foreigners from the north and from overseas in Europe, too. We are now," he says, "an international destination growing much faster than anyone could have anticipated." Me, Johnny here. Good luck with that. You know, he did mention advanced planning. Well, too bad that phrase, along with the word maintenance, don't happen to be part of the Spanish vocabulary. In fact, the gringos and expats living in Cuenca now are seeing it firsthand. They say it's a dichotomy. On the one hand, they're saying the government is incapable of balancing its budget. For example, the national health care system, once the pride of Ecuador, is now bankrupt and they just keep raising taxes and fees. Meanwhile, international lenders like the IMF just keep lending and lending. Yep, same old, just like in that famous little book, Confessions of an Economic Hitman by John Perkins. Have you read that? What an eye-opener. If not, put it on your reading list. Now, as for me, you know, I've been down here a long time, and there's a kind of a black irony and perversity to gringos having a plan B in a beautiful expat destination. Usually, certain places International Living and other rags are touting because they've got real estate to sell. To me, the real irony of it is that gringos and expats go to these places to escape what they immediately begin recreating. Like, for example, this little announcement that comes out of a Cuenca, Ecuador English language rag. It begins, "Come one, come all. The campaign to vaccinate against the flu and other viruses will last until February 28th. The free vaccine can be received at the Centro de Salud Health Center and is directed at children 6 months to 5 years old, seniors, and people with chronic illnesses." Just the kind of people that'll get even more sick and have bigger reactions to being injected with that kind of crap. Hey, why not take two? One in each arm. They're free. Man, you know, I just don't get it. Why do people come to Latin America to escape what they immediately try to recreate? Who's fooling who here? More to the point, who's the bigger fool? The fool or the fool who follows the fool? Or maybe it's the fool who's following the fool who's following the original fool. Which is why I always prefer to be in places that are off the gringo tourist trail or far enough from the gringo tourist trail that I don't see expats or gringos on a regular basis. In fact, where I'm at, I'd have to actually be on a mission to run into a gringo. And most of those gringos and expats are people that came down to one or more of my expat insider seminars and ended up here in Latin America permanently. And the thing is, most of them have taken my advice and are not directly on the gringo tourist trail. Though some are a half an hour to an hour outside of a gringo area, which is just fine too. That way you can have your gringo fix whenever you want it. Yet you could still enjoy a heavy dose of the gringo advantage when you're back home in your own neighborhood. Oh, and speaking of gringos on a mission, yep, no matter how far you are off the gringo tourist trail, once in a while you're bound to run into a few gringo do-gooders on a mission. That means Mormons, too. Yep, they're everywhere. And Mormons, yeah, they got the uniform. You can usually spot them at a great distance. And do-gooders, too. They always seem to have matching t-shirts that you could spot at a distance. Oh, and if you're stuck in an elevator with a couple of Mormons or do-gooders, if you want to get a lap, you can do what expat Eddie often does. He'll say, "Hey, any of you guys want to buy some weed?" Well, it's a kind of a test because Eddie says he's never yet met a Mormon. Actually, they travel in pairs, you know. That's a rule. Who's ever said, "Yeah, what do you got? How much?" Or, "No, that's all right. I'm okay through the weekend." They'll always say something like, No thanks, I'm not into that. Though they're so polite, you never know if they do or they don't. But Expat Eddie will also tell you there are plenty of kumbaya church-going do-gooders in matching t-shirts whose eyes will perk up and suddenly they'll want to be best friends with Eddie. But only when you get him alone or in pairs. Oh, and let me point out, Eddie is not a weed dealer. He's just with them. That's the way he is. Oh, by the way, is anyone out there keeping track of what's happening in Venezuela these days? You know, they had an election. Maduro won again because he changed the constitution, which in itself was unconstitutional. Then Venezuelans and the rest of the world saw that was an illegal move, and most other countries have recognized that the election wasn't legit. So instead of recognizing the guy from the other party, the guy Maduro tried to put in jail and make his party illegal, his name is Juan Guaido, something like that. Anyway, throughout the world, almost all first world countries are recognizing this guy as the new interim president. And even 3/4 of the rest of the 20 Latin countries are recognizing this guy as the interim leader, with most of them saying Maduro can't change his country's constitution, so his re-election is invalid. So then you might ask, which Latin countries are playing ball with Maduro? Well, you got Cuba, because they've been getting free oil from Venezuela for a long, long time. And Venezuela's got thousands of wage slave Cuban doctors stationed there, so you can expect Cuba is going to play ball. But oddly enough, one of the only other countries that's kissing up to Maduro is little Uruguay. And you wonder why. What kind of special relationship do they have with Venezuela? Well, you think it might have something to do with the fact that the president of Uruguay's son, his name is Javier Vasquez, he has a $62 million contract for the computerization of Venezuela's state communication company. And last year, the president of Uruguay's son pocketed $4.5 million for supposedly training Venezuelan personnel in the Ministry of Science and Technology. In addition, he's involved in a $1.2 million contract for a website administration in Venezuela and a $2.8 million contract for the management for the city halls in Venezuela. And an architectural consulting firm has 2 contracts underway, and he's a partner, for $3.5 million and another for $670,000. And it's not just hearsay. This was all confirmed by the son of Uruguay's president in a court case where it was shown that his accountant, who denounced those shady Venezuelan business deals, but he never did get to testify due to an alleged suicide, and the cases were closed. Oh, and this is from an article coming out of Uruguay's biggest newspaper. It says, while the average Venezuelan citizen has now lost 24 pounds due to malnutrition. Just this year, it's been found that the son of Uruguay's president, Vasquez, has received 7 huge wire transfers to a bank in a tax haven country, assumed to be Panama. The facturas, those would be the receipts, show that he received those payments from the Venezuelan government for his consulting services. So again, if you're wondering why, little Uruguay is one of the only holdouts in Latin America, one of the few countries that's supporting Maduro. Now I think you know the reason why. All right, now for an email. This one comes from Bob. He says, well, Johnny, way back in your early expat file days, you mentioned your rough plan was to eventually move to Colombia. Your early on PDF report about some cool spots to move in Latin America had about 3 Colombian spots listed, and also an island in the north of Venezuela. That's, I guess, how fluid things are down here and are about to get downright syrupy when the global currency reset kicks in, and it will. I wonder, he says, if it's not logical to just stay mobile, more or less, to adapt as things inevitably get more and more chaotic, even down here in Latin America. That's the rough formula that gypsies have used for centuries and centuries. That would be freedom equals anonymity equals mobility. Now he says, I'm not about to move out to the boonies myself and live like that, but it wouldn't be a bad plan C. After all, he says, indigenous ladies love gringos too. However, he says, in the 9 years I've been in Mexico, I'm seriously considering a semi-permanent place to flop down and maybe build an off-the-grid house. Besides, he says, I've seen social climates change radically in places like Uruguay, Venezuela, Colombia, even Chile. Honduras just had a coup and saw a new U.S. military base installed. How about that? He says, I know you still recommend Guatemala and a few others for residency, but how long before the soldiers start heading out to plow various Indian villages under again over there? I'd say in this overall climate of radically changing conditions, maybe it's good to have another plan B. A plan B to the plan B, or maybe a small base in different bordering countries and the ability to move there quickly if need be. One of your original cool expat locale choices, Arequipa, might not be too bad. A tri-border area with Argentina, just a bit farther. Makes for lots of options. Meanwhile, nearly everywhere in Latin America, you can spend $4 for a Starbucks coffee or go to a local diner and get the same thing or better for a buck and some change. All right, Bob, thanks for that. Well, I'll tell you, I wrote that report around 8 years ago now, and things change, as they always do. Look, back then, international living was still pounding on Costa Rica and Panama, which are now ruined. And of course, now they're all over the big cities in Colombia and Ecuador. So that means you could do all the internet investigations you want, all the boots on the ground investigations throughout Latin America you want. But when one of those big, notorious rags like international living or AARP suddenly decide to put a nice, calm, beautiful expat paradise on the radar, all bets are off. Oh, and Bob, you talk about being kind of a nomad. Well, you can only do that if you're a single. If you've got a spouse or kids or a significant other, it becomes extremely difficult to remain on the move. Hey, I've done it. I've moved around a lot. But eventually, you end up in a place you really like. Though the idea is to always keep your options open. And of course, I'm 100% with you talking about the imminent crash of the first world monetary system. And of course, it'll have its effects on Latin America, too, which will be a topic of discussion in the next show. So stay tuned. We'll talk about how things will fare down here in Latin America when all that comes down. Just remember this. There's no such thing as a dangerous country, only dangerous neighborhoods. And there's no such thing as a safe country, only safe neighborhoods. So no matter where you are, it's all about the neighborhood. Oh, and before we sign off today, remember to pick up my 100-page Latin American healthcare report. It's my own personal step-by-step guide on how you can get first-world healthcare at third-world prices. And that means whatever hospital, doctor, clinic, or procedure you get up in the States, you'll be able to get down here. Same quality, same professionally trained people, same equipment, but for a quarter to a sixth of what you'll pay for the same thing up in the States. Just go to theexpatfiles.com/healthcare.
You've been listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America. If you need some help with your own Plan B, you can schedule a one-on-one phone call with me. But first, download my free Plan B questionnaire at www.thenewexpat.com. Better yet, if you want to get your Plan B going from right up there in the States, just sign up for my 9-hour Expat Essentials course. Get the perfect Plan B blueprint by going to theexpatfiles.com/academy. Nos vemos!